Hello and welcome along to another episode of My Football Story from the Honest Football Podcast. Each week we talk to a guest from the footballing world about their career, their story and their life in football and how they fell in love with the beautiful game. And this week Charlie did a really interesting one. He spoke to Shannon Clucas, a player who's got experiences in various countries and is still actively playing over in Northern Ireland. He's got experiences in the English Football League, playing for Preston, Burton and Bristol Rovers, before moving on to play both sides of the Irish border domestically, for Derry City over in the Republic of Ireland, and then for Linfield, Dungannon, his hometown, and now Glentoran in Northern Ireland. Shannon's also represented Northern Ireland at every level up to under-21s, so has plenty of international experience to talk about as well. He's of course over that time worked with a number of different styles of players and managers, and has an interesting brief stint in Australia to talk about too. So this is My Football Story with Shannon Clucas. We really hope you enjoy it. If you do, please put a thumbs up on the video, subscribe to the channel for weekly interviews and regular podcasts from us. But I'll go and hand over to Charlie and Shannon now, and I really hope you enjoy this one.
I'm delighted to say that Shannon's with us now. So Shannon, thanks so much for joining us. Really appreciate you coming on today and giving up your time on a Friday especially. So yeah, thanks so much for being here.
Not a problem. Hey, thanks very much for having me on.
No problem. So, obviously, we're going to talk a bit more about, you know, you've obviously had a recent move to Glentoran and stuff, but we'll get all the way up to that towards the later on in the episode. But what we always do is we always sort of start where, you know, for any footballer, whether it's someone at the elite level or even sort of grassroots football more where I am, but where that sort of journey started for you, really. So, what's your sort of first football memory, whether it be in sort of playing or watching or anything like that, really? Where did it all begin for you?
First football memories would be I grew up in a town called Dungannon. And Joe McGarry, who runs Dungannon United Youth, he would have started football, the football summer camps and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So I think I was about five or six, when I joined them. Mm-hmm. So it was just going down to there. And I think their youth team setup started, I think it was under 9 or 10s, you know, when you get picked for the actual teams to play on a Saturday. So I just started kicking a ball ever since I can remember. I know during Christmas, I think I got a football when I was 2 or 3, and it's the first thing I gravitated towards. So yeah, they were my earliest memories of playing football.
Do you remember the sort of first game that you watched on, you know, like be on TV or going to a ground or anything like that sort of?
I can't really remember. The first Liverpool game I actually ever went to was young, and Liverpool played, I'm nearly sure it was Bayer Leverkusen or someone over at Windsor over here.
Oh, okay.
Over at Windsor Park. So it was like a pre-season sort of friendly type thing. So that was my first experience at a proper big football game, and it was one my dad took me to. But that's probably vaguely my first ever proper game of watching football now.
So obviously you mentioned that you went through sort of Dungannon in terms of that youth sort of set up, etc. But then you actually went over the water, as they say, didn't they? And you end up at Preston. How did that all sort of come about, really? Because you know, you do hear obviously players coming across, but you know, how did that actually happen for you in that sense?
Yeah. So at the current time I was playing with Dungannon, I think it would have been under 14, 15 then. Then we played, I was selected for the Northern Ireland 17s. Mm-hmm. So we were playing a in-house game against the under 16 Northern Ireland team, who was actually going on to play the Victory Shield.
Right, yeah, of course, yeah, yeah.
Do you know the Victory Shield?
So yeah.
In-house game, and as I say, there was plenty of scouts and stuff at the game. But I happened to play very well that game. You know, just luck To be able to perform at that stage and at that time and have the scouts there and be able to have a good game. Then I had 3 or 4 teams looking me over on trial. So I think it was that summer then I went on trial to Fulham first, which I didn't do too great. It was sort of alien to me, as I said, it was the first time I went over. And then I went to Derby, where I'd done all right. And from then I went to Preston. And at Preston had done very well. So these were all week to weeks. So it was just 1 week there, next week there. It was continuous. Done very well at Preston. And at the end of the week, they had offered me a 2-year scholar. So a deal straight away. I was supposed to go to Everton then after.
Right.
Which is probably a bit of a regret that I didn't go, because looking back, I probably should have, just to keep my options open. But I felt really settled at Preston.
Yeah,
and obviously once they offered me the deal, I just see myself being there. As I say, there was the likes of Conor McLaughlin, Neil Dugan, Jimmy Douglas, Scott Davison, Michael McClellan, Don Devine, who were all Northern Irish lads, who were all signed to there.
Yeah.
Which sort of would have, was a massive help for me settling in. And I've no regrets joining Preston. No. I had a very, very, very good time there.
Yeah, from a footballing perspective, obviously you mentioned you're playing for the national team, so obviously you know the standard of that is incredible. Is there what's the biggest difference when you come over then in terms of, you know, going from playing for Dungannon, you know, even in the youth setup, to then that sort of scholarship? What is it, like the speed? Is it the physicality? What's the sort of biggest difference when you came over to sort of play for Preston in that sense? The first thing that sort of
I think it's just more getting the physicality and getting used to being full time. Training every day. You know, at Dungannon, we only train twice a week and then we had a match on Saturday. When you go over there, you're going into a professional environment and you're seeing first team players, the likes of Neil Miller and Clark Carlisle. And it's just you get that sort of, as cheesy as it may sound, that wow factor of seeing them type of players. And, you know, you see them on TV and then you're going and training beside them. I adapted quite well. I got probably homesick maybe a month or two, but I think the fact that all them Northern Irish lads were there, we all sort of helped each other stay grounded and feel it felt like you're home away from home, if that makes sense. It was definitely a lot easier having all them boys there.
Yeah, of course. What's that first day like when you sort of, you know, you go to train with the first team with these lads? Do you sort of, I mean, what's your mentality like? Sorry, do you sort of feel like you have to go and stamp your authority a bit almost, or do you just sort of sit on the periphery, you know, because you've obviously lived the dream and played professional football, unlike people like myself would love to, but obviously we're nowhere near good enough. So what's that sort of first day like when you do go train with the first team and stuff like that?
Yeah, well, I can only speak for me. My mindset was always to go and stamp your authority and get after people and show respect, but not give too much respect. Yeah. If you know you want to go there, and at the end of the day, football's a business. You have to look at the person who's in your position and want to go and take a shirt. And at the time when I was breaking through at Preston, it was Ian Ashby, former Hull City captain. Yeah. I remember the first training session with him. The first time I got a chance to chap him, that's what I done. Yeah, but that was just my mentality. I think that's the mentality you have to have if you want to succeed there, because like I said, it's a business, and if you're not wanting to take someone else's jersey or upset them just because you want to play ahead of them, you're never going to make it. So
no, I appreciate you being so honest about that. You know, even over here I was never anywhere good enough, but I just had a couple of sort of, I was at a couple of academies as a kid, but the whole sort of principle, I really struggled to get my head around playing for a team. But then, like you say, the whole thing of not being selfish, but you obviously want to get yourself, you know, almost hoping that your other centre half messes up or something like that, as silly as it sounds, it makes you look better.
Yes.
But it's such a strange mentality, isn't it? But anyway, that's they're not here to talk about me. It's obviously about you. So obviously that sort of growing up in Preston, you ended up at Bristol Rovers. How did that sort of come around? Because that's obviously, you know, quite a change in terms of different part of the country and all of that. How was that a choice of yours, or was it sort of something that was sort of forced on you a bit more?
It was one of them ones where, you know, Graham Wesley came in and sort of shook things up at Preston and got rid of the majority of players and the majority of the backroom staff and my ex-youth team coaches who had been so successful there. It was sad to leave Preston, you know, as I really enjoyed myself there, and I wish that journey could have continued, but I ended up, my agent got me the move to Bristol. He knew the manager at the time, who was Mark McGee, and there wasn't many options for me, to be honest, because, you know, I'd only just had a few brief games with Preston. But yeah, it was sort of forced on me, but you know, I didn't know much about Bristol. Didn't even know where it was when he was telling me, but he was just saying, listen, it's a good opportunity for you. You know, you're been down to League Two, where if you want to play men's football and try and get in a first team week in, week out, you know, that's the place to start. So yeah, that's what brought me down to Bristol.
So you obviously mentioned about the you know, in terms of the going from maybe a club like Preston to then League Two with Bristol Rovers. What's the is there a difference in the style of football? Is it a bit more long ball? Do you know, like, do you get more time on the ball? I don't know. You know, obviously, what is the sort of difference in those sort of environments?
I think League Two is just it's frantic. You know, you don't get a minute of the ball. It's quite like over here in the northern Premiership. You know, you get no there's no hiding place, and you know, you'll not get 2 or 3 seconds of the ball. You know, it's getting it and giving it, and balls over the top, and you know, it's more of a scrap. Whereas in the Championship, Preston or League One, you know, the quality as you go up the leagues, obviously there's no doubt the quality of play and players improve drastically.
Which is sort of something I wanted to sort of move on to. Obviously, you know, playing a lot at Bristol Rovers, but unfortunately the club was then relegated at the end of your... What's the feeling around a club in that sort of situation? Because obviously, I know it's not a nice time, but I imagine going out of a football league, particularly, you know, people in the back room and that who are going to lose jobs, is it as sad and as tough as it sort of appears to us sort of fans from the outside, if that makes sense?
Yeah, it's horrible. It's a feeling that I never ever want to experience again. Obviously, I was let go then because of the budget, and they had to make cuts, and I was on the final year of my contract. John Ward, he had signed Ollie Clark and Tom Lockyer, sort of similar ages to me. They had signed another 2 year while I was out with my cruciate.
Yeah,
you know, so they had the backup and stuff there, and two great players who, you know, they didn't need me then. But I think it's just more of it's the disappointment you feel. You know, you feel like you let a city down. Do you know what I mean? You know, especially Bristol Rovers. You know, their fan base and their fans were absolutely superb. The time I was there. So yeah, you carry that burden with yourself, and it's just disappointing. And it's not a nice feeling to have now, definitely not.
No, just before we sort of move on to what happened next to you after that, obviously something you mentioned about that cruciate injury, which is something that I suppose us grassroots footballers can relate to. But we, as a podcast, did an episode a few months ago because we'd all three of us who run the podcast had had like a cruciate injury or something similar. And just the effect it had on our mental health and our mentality. How did you find that whole experience? Because obviously a cruciate injury, I did exactly the same, albeit I fell down the stairs, not playing football. But it's a long period, isn't it, to be out of the game and that kind of thing. How did you sort of cope with that? Because for me, I really struggled even in grassroots football.
It was very, very tough, to be honest. I probably, looking back now, I was thinking I probably didn't struggle with it. But looking back now, I did. I found myself, whenever they were travelling to away games, if it was far, they would travel down on a Friday night and I'd be in the apartment on my own. Actually found myself going up, there was a Wetherspoons up the top of the road, and I'd be sitting there taking pints by myself.
Yeah.
You know, and that's probably, looking back, I didn't think then now, but probably looking back, I would probably be just trying to suppress, you know, maybe not being there, not being part of the squad, and maybe feeling left out. But I found it tough. It was very, very tough. But don't get me wrong, I done my work.
Yeah.
And I got back. I got back very, very quick. I think I was back after 6 months. I was running after 5.
Right.
Back at 6.5. I'm playing my first competitive game, reserve game, after 7 months, bang on.
Army, wow.
But no, it was tough because at that part of my stage of my career with Rovers, you know, I was flying. I was playing really, really well.
Yeah.
I'd found out later then, I think it was just after I went back with the under-21s, they called me back into the squad, and Stevie Robinson, the manager, who's now at Motherwell, said to me, you know, he wants me to come back. I was one of the more senior players and he wanted me to get a hold of the boys and whatnot. And he says, I know it's disappointing for you with the whole Stoke thing falling through and stuff. And I sort of stopped him and said, you know, what do you mean?
Right.
And he explained to me, you know, Stoke were coming in for a bid that summer for, you know, the way they'd set up the under-23 Premier League.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
So Pulis, he was supposedly coming in with, it was 200, and the reason the 200 grand bid that year. And then I only found out 10 months later.
Right.
So I rang my agent then. I rang my agent straight away after when I found out. And he was just saying, listen, he didn't want to tell me because... No. Number one, I've just done my cruciate. He didn't want to put that, you know, he didn't want to probably put me in that mental state throwing that on top of me as well. So, it's like I said, it's that wee bit of luck you need in football, and sometimes you get it and sometimes you don't. But you know, I'm blessed and I'm happy of the career I've had. You know, I've went over to England and I've lived my dream for as short as it was. But you know, I tasted that bit of success.
Yeah.
So
no, I think it's
I can't dwell on it.
No, I appreciate you being so honest about that. Honestly, I think it's you know, something we can. I can't relate to being a bid for Stoke coming in for me, but I can understand the sort of frustration. And for me, it was a bit more of a gambling thing than drinking. But yeah, being off work and stuff was tough. But that kind of thing. But anyway, on to a more sort of a football related note. Obviously, you then came back home, obviously to Northern Ireland. So it's a league that my family obviously, my wife's family live near Ballymena, so I'd sort of go and watch them as often as I can if we go over. So I'm familiar with the Irish league and just. For me, it's probably the most entertaining football I've watched, you know, being, you know, much football watching England. But you obviously started out at Linfield, going back. How did that come about? Was that your first choice to come back home, or was there other options for you before you sort of thought about that?
When I came back home, Linfield was probably the biggest club over here. You know, they've got the financial backing and stuff. So I thought, yeah, it was a good place for me to go back and maybe start playing more games of football and try and enjoy it again. But it just never ended up like that. I was sort of in and out, and Warren Feeney, he was in charge. He was the one that signed me. But didn't get a long one.
No.
At the start I did. You know, he was one of them ones, he'd fill you full of shit. Oh, sorry, can I say that?
Yeah, of course, yeah. fill you full of
shit and then tell you one thing and then go and do something different. You know, for example, he rang me one time. Wasn't really playing, and he rang me the morning of the game on the Saturday and says, listen, hockey's injured, so you're in, you're going to be playing, you're going to be starting. He says, I need you ready, and such and such. So I agreed. Next thing I turned up, got to the ground. Next thing, Fino pulled me, and I says, so I was thinking he was just looking to, you know, go through what he wanted from me and what he expected, and that was all right. He pulled me and he says, listen, you're not starting. Such and such, and then I wasn't even on the bench, so I think that do you know what I mean? It was that type of stuff, so that sort of done it for me. So it did. So no, it didn't really work out at Linfield at all.
No, do you know? I've got to be honest, Shannon. We spoke to a lot of people from different parts of the game, and I think all anyone ever wants from a football manager is just sort of honesty, isn't it? Regardless of, you know, whether you agree with their tactics or, you know, anything like that. I think if you can just throw up front with you, that's
all you want. You just somebody straightforward gives you, you know, if you're not in his plans, you're not in his plans. If he doesn't see you fit for that game, he doesn't, you know, just tell it how it is. I know if I was in the other position, if I was a manager, that's what you want to be like. You know, you want to be straight up and you want with your players, because at the end of the day, if you don't be like that, you know, players talk. So no matter what, you'll be found out. So
No, I completely understand your feelings for that. I think I feel exactly the same, whether it's grassroots football or the elite level where you are. But obviously, you had a short stint then at Derry. Just on that sort of thing, is there a difference? Because obviously, I've only really ever watched obviously Northern Irish League quite close. I follow that closely, but I've never really watched the League of Ireland in that sense. I know you weren't there for very long in the grand scheme of things, but is there much of a difference? Obviously, one's a bit more professional in terms of the, you know, the number of hours that players are in and stuff, but is there much of a difference in the standard at all, or not really?
To be honest, down south, it's a lot better. I wouldn't say a lot better. And maybe years ago it would have been a lot better, but it's I think it's definitely a jumping standard. With your main 5-6 teams, you know, at the top of the likes of Shamrock Rovers and Dundalk and them type of teams, they're definitely further ahead. But listen, the Irish League up here, like I said in a recent podcast, I came home from Bristol and I sort of disrespected the league, you know, as if I was just gonna walk in and it was gonna be easy, which was probably my downfall when I was probably at Linfield. But the standard in the league goes up and up every year, quality wise. Which is testament to the players and the coaching that's going on over here. So it's improving every year, which is better. But I was your question. I would say down south, it's probably more ahead. But that's obviously that's because they've got full time. Yeah. They're all full time clubs, like. So, but I'm sure if you made and it's looking like it's going that way, where more clubs up here are going full time. So. No, but I'd definitely say down south's probably just a step ahead, obviously, because they're full-time.
Do you, that putting you on the spot, do you think it'll ever get to the stage where there's like maybe a, not necessarily a league, but, you know, an all-Ireland competition and that kind of thing, you know? Because it's been sort of spoken about sort of fairly recently, hasn't it?
They've been talking about it, yeah. Who knows? I think it'll be hard to do because, and some people won't favour because they like the Ireland field and your Crusaders and stuff, you know, they'll go down the pecking order again because of the clubs down south, so... I guess one, I don't really know much on. I haven't really looked into it that much. But if it was to do it, it can only benefit Irish football. If it was to go down that route, as I say, I wouldn't be keen on doing it now because I'm turning 28, like, and obviously I've got a job and stuff too. So yeah. That full time option is probably not going to be for me again. So
no. No, I see. I appreciate you sort of being honest in terms of, I suppose, that full-time option, like you say, for some people, it's, you know, in the infancy for a lot of clubs. And I suppose if you depend on your job, it's not always financially viable to go full-time, is it, I suppose? And
no.
The travel and stuff like that. But you obviously, before you went back to Dungannon, where it all obviously started, I know you had a bit of a break in Australia and, you know, there was a possibility of signing for a club. But then you sort of took a year out and you don't necessarily need to go into sort of details of that. But do you think that actually made your career a bit longer now? Are you sort of, do you think you're still playing now because of maybe that year out that you had between sort of leaving Derry and then Dungannon?
What triggered it was I went to Derry and I just knew, you know, I was probably drinking too much and probably not being as professional as I should have been. I said drinking at the weekends and messing about and I just realised I wasn't, you know, my full focus wasn't on football no more and I wasn't really enjoying it. So and I wasn't enjoying being back home, sorry, too. So I was given the chance to go to Australia. I had trials with Newcastle Jets and Adelaide United lined up. So I was scrambling then, getting the flights booked and stuff. And I'd booked the flights and like 3 months later I was going out. So I had no time to even really think. But I think I was just happy enough to get away. So before I was flying out, their manager, I think he got sacked or he got to move to the MLS.
Right.
And so the trials, I ended up flying out anyway. The trials were, you know, didn't want me then.
Right.
So I was left in limbo when I was over there. Luckily enough, I was over there. I was staying with family in Adelaide. I've got family and cousins and stuff in Adelaide. Right. So it wasn't too bad. But then I ended up signing one of the national teams or the Bay State team,
right?
Adelaide Comets. So I was signed there, and I was gonna have like a coaching job on the side and stuff. And I say I trained, had the jersey and stuff and all up on Twitter, yeah. And the whole thing. And I trained once, and I got home and I thought about it, and I goes, you know what? I just didn't want to do it. You know, I thought at this stage maybe a year ago and doing what I wanted and traveling and maybe take a year out. So that's what I ended up doing because I know a lot of lads think like this who go across the water and they always feel like they're missing that, you know, their mates going to uni and stuff and they're missing out on all that partying. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think you've touched on obviously how much of a sacrifice you have to make to play at that level. Is, you know, that's a prime example of it, isn't it? I think I don't know if people necessarily realise how much you have to give up to perform at the level that you do, almost in that sense.
No, you do. Don't get me wrong, you're living your dream, and it's a selfish way to look at it. But when you're over there and you're doing it, and your mates are all, you know, going to uni and you're missing out and going on holidays because they would go July and August and your friends from back home and you would never get to go with them because we would be off May and June. So in that regard, it was tough, but I couldn't complain. But Australia. So I ended up traveling on a party, and I probably partied a bit too hard to the point where I was just fed up and sick of it.
Yeah.
I realised then, I needed that routine in my life. What I've had from when I was over in England as a 16-year-old boy. I needed that structure in my life.
I completely understand what you mean. I think it's, if you've gone from that to then just, I suppose everything in football's regimented, isn't it? I suppose you know what time you're training, where you're going to be, etc. Yeah. So to go from that then to sort of, I can completely understand where you're coming from.
Just completely unstable.
Yeah.
And you could get away with anything and you could do what you want. I think I got the 11, it was 11 months in. Mm. And we'd been on a tour, it was two or three days we were on the drink for. But don't get me wrong, this was every week again for my last 4 months, two or three days in the drink. But it felt like the norm out there.
Yeah.
Everybody traveling, and it was that sort of culture, and that sort of everyone was on the same. But I think it was after 11 months, it got too much for me, and I ended up, I rang my dad and says, listen, I need to get home.
Yeah.
So I ended up booking the flights home and just realized that, that going down that road, it was only ever going to end up one way, and it was disaster. And at that time too, I'd been missing football, realized, I'd wanted to get back, and Rodney McRae, who's up in Yansuffs, he had rang me a month prior, asking what I was going to do, and, was coming home and stuff. So,
yeah.
So luckily enough, I came home and I was hungry again.
Yeah, no, I appreciate you being so honest about that. I think it's, I think a lot of people can relate to that. So I appreciate you sort of being so open about that. It's, but yeah, obviously moving back on towards the sort of football, obviously at Dungannon then for sort of next 4 years and winning the League Cup against Ballymena. My father-in-law wasn't too happy that day, but obviously it's that kind of thing. But just really quickly, obviously in terms of that, going that full circle, I suppose, before we move on to the last part of your career, what would be your highlight of sort of playing for Dungannon? Because I suppose it's where you started and then you end up being captain, of course, as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Obviously, a highlight was getting the captaincy, but winning the League Cup, Dungannon's first ever major trophy was probably the best moment of my career. That and probably making my debut for Preston, or both knacking neck. So, especially because it's my boyhood club. I grew up there, and had Christopher Haggerty, who grew up playing football with too, was playing too. Paul McRae, all these boys, local lads from Dungannon, winning Dungannon's first senior trophy was definitely memorable. Now.
Yeah, and obviously playing for your national team as well, just sort of to touch on that, I suppose, that's something that you, like you said earlier, living the dream, but getting to represent your country, obviously, I suppose that must mean a lot, but would you say that maybe your time at Dungannon, maybe winning those trophies would mean more than representing your country? Like, where does it sort of sit on that scale, if that makes sense?
No, listen, Dungannon's head and shoulders above anything that I've done internationally. Obviously, it was a privilege and an honour, and the players and the teams that you come up against and stuff, but no, definitely my time at Dungannon, obviously giving the captaincy and then mostly winning the League Cup was right up there.
No, definitely. And obviously now you're, I suppose you mentioned earlier about luck, but you signed for Glentoran and then we have a pandemic, so it sort of doesn't quite go in your favour. But I've got to be honest, the last Irish League game I went to was Ballymena Glentoran. I think it was just before you signed. But probably my favourite ground is the Oval. I've been to a lot of football grounds.
That was when was that at the Oval, you watched it?
Yeah, that was when they had the midfielder in goal. I can't remember his name for something now. Ballymena. Oh, jeez, what was his name? Declan Carville, So he was in goal. And to be honest, I think they held him out for about 85 minutes, I think it was. And then it was a... But anyway, going over that again. But yeah, I've got to be honest, the Oval was a fantastic place to watch football. But obviously, you played there maybe as an opposition. But how did that move come about? Is it something for sort of, I suppose, given everything back to Dungannon, I suppose, when you...
I came about, I think it was, I had heard they were interested then and they were looking to sign me at the start of last year, so in August. So I think they'd made a bid. I think they had bid, I can't remember how much it was, but they'd bid money anyway. And the manager, Chris Lindsay, he pulled me in and he says, listen, I had a year left on my contract, you see, and I'd just been given the captaincy. So at the time, I didn't want to go. Obviously, it was a big move. Obviously, they had a lot of financial backing with the new owner and stuff. And always said, no, this is going to be my last season with again, and I'll see at the end of the season, what happens. So I said, listen, I don't want to go. But they didn't want to let me go either. So it was a mutual decision. So, and then we started off well with again, and we were flying.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Started the season really well and things were going good, and then obviously things started not to go so great, and we were down around the bottom three. And then the January window opened, they were still looking to sign me, so I just made the conscious decision, Glentoran were flying at the time, we just made the conscious decision that if it was to get injured or something was to happen, you know, that opportunity's gone. So, you know, looking back at it now, it's probably the right move, because if it didn't leave, it didn't leave in January, you know, this pandemic's happened, you know, I'd be with Dungannon and I'd be out of contract. And,
yeah.
You know, where do I go? So, no, but it was a tough decision, but one I had to make. Plus, my girlfriend, she lives up here in East Belfast in Dundonald, and, you know, everything made sense for me to go.
I think, to be honest, I mean, up until a few weeks before the season, obviously had to stop. It was, you know, the tightest. I'd been watching Irish League football for about 6 or 7 years, but the top of the table was so tight. And
yeah.
I think Glentoran have been such a, you know a lot better than me, but, you know, a lot of a sort of a bit of a roller coaster journey. When I first started watching, I think they'd just signed Nacho Novo and they were languishing sort of 7th, 8th in the table each year. And not each year, but, you know, for a couple of years. But having watched them again recently, you know, they're definitely, and obviously signing players like yourself makes a massive difference. So hopefully, you know, all the best in terms of that. And maybe they'll sneak up for Linfield next season or whatever. But
hopefully.
Just wanted to move on just to some quick fire ones just to finish off with, if that's all right.
Yep.
Really quickly, in terms of, you know, I love Irish League rounds and I've been to, not all of them, but quite a few, apart from Warren Point. I haven't gone down that far yet, but that's quite a trip for Antrim, to be fair. But in terms of
that's
your
track.
It is, to be fair, yeah, you know. So
it's a track.
I wouldn't, you know, maybe one day, but as a player, obviously, what is your sort of favourite ground? It doesn't have to be an Irish League one, but, you know, what's your favourite ground you've ever played at?
Irish League ground is Stanmore Park.
All right,
Swifts. Love playing there. The size of the pitch, the way the pitch is kept, it's usually in very, very good condition, so. Over in England, where was my favourite place that I played? Probably Deepdale. Deepdale was, you know, have you been to Deepdale?
I've watched the game there once, I was a kid, but I was on a football tour.
Yeah, just the stadium and stuff, just, it was brilliant. I made my debut there too, so it's, so it's one of them that'll live long in the memory too, so Deepdale's up there too.
Yeah, I suppose a club like that, sort of, you know, that sort of facilities and staying deserves to be in the sort of championship and that, really, didn't it? But it's sort of best player you've played with or against, or both, really. You know, that's right. I know you played against Edgar Davids once, but I suppose I don't know when he was a bit further on.
I did. I was past his best then, so I was running over the top of him that game. So
no, sure.
That's saying something. Best player I've played with or against Tevez. Probably Tevez.
All right, wow. Bloody hell.
Yeah, we went.
That's a name drop, that.
No, I feel like a dick.
No, at all. No, I'm a West Ham fan, so he kept our club afloat.
Look at him name dropping.
No, I think it's brilliant. No, I'm you know, I think
Do you know what happened with that, though? He went, mate, he went to Ewell and started playing golf and stuff. He, it was his first game back, and it was behind closed doors, a reserve game.
Oh, okay,
so
right.
It was. So we played them at Man City's new training complex in a behind closed doors game, and he played up front. So
was he that good? Was he? Or?
So to be honest, he was walking about, and you could tell he wasn't really arsed, like, but when he had the ball at his feet, like, he was magic.
Yeah. Second to last question: the best manager that you've had, and you've had, you know, obviously maybe not Warren Feeney, obviously, but you know, anyone else?
Best manager I've had. See, to be honest, this might surprise you. See, my youth team coach, Jimmy Hoyland.
Mm-hmm. No, doesn't surprise me.
Probably when I was at Preston, Jimmy Hoyland, him and Dean Ramsdale. You know, the work they had done at Preston and the trophies and the players that they brought through that youth system who are still over in England playing today. It would definitely be them. Like,
And the last question, I think that's actually quite interesting, you know, in terms of the, I suppose it's your formative years, isn't it, as a footballer? So it's good that you sort of treasure that. But the last question's got two parts. So this series originally started as a My Favourite Game sort of series, branched it out. But normally we just get people from different parts of football and they'll just say the favourite of a game they've watched. But obviously, because you know, you're a pro and playing at the elite level and, you know, played in it, you know, in some fantastic games, we'll give you two. So what is your favourite ever game that you've ever played in? And then the favourite one that you've ever watched that you weren't obviously directly involved in?
Favourite game I've ever played in is that McLean League Cup final with Ian Swifts.
Yeah.
Obviously, because of what it was and the whole occasion. It was my first senior trophy too, just as well as Dungannon's. And best game I've ever watched, did you say?
Yeah. It could have been on TV, it could have been at the ground. What is the best ever football match you've ever seen?
Liverpool Milan Champions League final 2005.
Yeah, it's incredible.
All day.
Yeah.
Or the Barcelona.
Yeah.
Last year.
I don't mean
2 years ago.
Cracking games.
Barcelona and Liverpool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a Liverpool. I'm a big Liverpool fan. So.
Yeah. The thing is, it's fascinating because I think with the Milan one, I mean, Steven Gerrard literally dragged the whole team through that, didn't he? So I think
unbelievable.
It's incredible. Sort of, and you'd appreciate that as a, obviously, you know, playing as a midfielder and stuff.
So yeah.
It's, you know, that's fantastic. I really appreciate your honesty for this today. And, you know,
no problem, mate.
Obviously, all the best with Glentoran whenever this gets started, and hopefully everyone sort of is fit and well before we sort of kick off again. But just really quickly, if anyone wants to sort of keep up in contact and up to date in terms of social medias and stuff, you know, what's going on with your career, where's best to sort of find you in that on sort of Twitter and stuff? So
yeah, Twitter is Seanan_Clucas04, I think it is.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
And just again, my name on Instagram, Seanan_Clucas.
Top man. Seanan, yeah. Thanks so much for that. I really appreciate you giving up the time. And hopefully all the best, and we'll catch up with you soon.
All the best for the rest of your podcast. So thanks very much for having me on. I really appreciate it.